This week on the Music Biz Weekly podcast, we dig into social networks and social media marketing. You know, it's those basics that every artist has got to be involved in, but to some extent, every artist is like, keep me away from it. I don't want to deal with that stuff. I just want to play my music. Well, social marketing is a critical part, and we talk about what's going on in that space right now.
Welcome to the Music Biz Weekly podcast, founded in 2011. And with over 500 weekly episodes, where Michael Brandvold and Jay Gilbert, two longtime music industry pros, discuss the very latest trends, tools, and tactics that you need to succeed in this.
Everybody, welcome back to another episode of the Music Biz Weekly podcast. You got Mike, you got Jay, and we got a cool discussion coming up with a guest that's all about social media, marketing, social networks, vertical videos, what's going on out there. But before we get into that, just a quick shout out and thank you to Bruce and everybody at Hypebot and Bandsintown. And of course, to our sponsor, discmakers.com. If you're a musician and you've been thinking of launching your next album as digital only, Discmakers has created an offer just for you. Get 100 CDs and custom printed jackets for just $149. At this price, there's no risk to try CDs. CD jackets are lightweight and perfect for mailings, selling at shows, and are easy to hand out as demos. They're also a great way to bond with fans while making some extra gig revenue. God, making revenue is so important right now. Our friends at Discmakers are the place to go for your physical media, including vinyl, custom vinyl, manufacturing, and USB drives. Here's an offer we got for you. Go over to discmakers.com. Get yourself 100 CDs in custom printed jackets for just $149 for a limited time. That's discmakers.com. Jay, who's sitting down with us today and what are we chatting about?
We have a great conversation with Cassie Petrie. She is the co-founder and co-CEO of a company called CrowdSurf, and they do marketing, social media, like you mentioned, and they also do music management. They do a lot of things. So a lot of expertise to draw from.
Yeah, this is a good conversation. I think everybody needs to give it a listen. It's a good update on what's going on in social networks, social media marketing today, yeah, because it's going to all be changing by next week. But give this a listen and we'll see you at the end.
Subscribe on YouTube. Follow and rate us on Spotify. Subscribe and leave a review on iTunes. We appreciate it.
Today, we are joined by Cassie Petrie. Cassie, thanks so much for joining us from beautiful Santa Monica. You are the co-founder, CEO of CrowdSurf. Tell us a little bit, for those that don't know, what is CrowdSurf? What is your superpower? What do you guys do?
So CrowdSurf is a digital marketing company that primarily works with music and other types of talent. And we help them with various things involving social media, fan engagement, and just making their lives easier. We also have an artist management sector of the company as well, where we have several artists that we do traditional talent management for.
Nice. That's a lot.
Awesome. Let's chat a little bit about TikTok and like vertical video and where that's going. You know, I mean,
short form videos.
I mean, how do I want to phrase this? TikTok is here unless the government decides to freaking ban it, which I don't think will end up happening. YouTube Shorts kind of came out of nowhere. People didn't really give it a lot of credit initially, but I feel like it's kind of exploding. And then you got Facebook/Instagram and Reels. And it's almost like every day we wake up and we have no idea what Mark Zuckerberg's going to do with Instagram, Facebook, and Reels. Where do you see all of this going?
All the platforms you just mentioned, yes, they're going to continue rolling out new tools and be trying new things all the time. And right now, a lot of that is very vertical video centric, because that's, and what, why things are vertical video centric is because that's how most people organically film now. They don't turn
people forget to flip their camera for the longest time. I remember as a social media person, I'd always beat up clients going, make sure you rotate your camera when you film it. Now I'm like, don't rotate your camera when you film it. Make sure it's vertical.
Yeah. So I think it's evolved from like just that kind of natural behavior. It's more comfortable, you know, you can film with one hand versus two, yep. You know, it sounds simple, but I think just human behavior and hardware really dictated where it always has dictates, you know, where social media goes. So that's why sure. we're, you know, seeing a lot of, you know, tools on that front. What I do think is going to happen in terms of new platforms or new priorities within social media in the next 12 to 24 months, I think we're going to see a rise in either existing platforms or new platforms that help people figure out what to do in real life. My dream app is the app that I open, and it's called the What Am I Doing Tonight app. And I look at it and it shows everything around me that's going on that I can go do that's like fun or random or my friends are doing, but that's like the app that I want to see. And there's a lot of apps that have pieces of that. But I think that applications that help people find things to do in real life, that's what I'm like betting on as the next big winner in social media, because I think people yeah. are getting, you know, the screens are, you know, we're kind of fatigued on it and people want to go do fun things. I've been organizing some of my own random fun things to do with people, and that's gone over really well just within the people I know. I organized a nunchucks class with some of my friends, which was really fun. At my boyfriend's birthday party, we hired like a local magician and had him come over and do some tricks. But I think people are looking just for memorable experiences, and technology that helps that happen is going to, I think, have a really big leg up.
Do you think part of my frustration is, and I think Facebook to some extent is behind a lot of this frustration. You get these platforms that just keep adding a brand new feature set and a brand new feature set and a brand new feature set. And, you know, and again, we'll just use Facebook as the perfect example. I mean, it does how many different things that you're like, well, where the hell did that go? It was here last week and now they moved it over here. And, oh, this week they want to try and, you know, it was like, oh, first we want to be a Snapchat clone and now we want to be a TikTok clone. And now we're going to add these features. And is what you're talking about, do you think needs to kind of become its own brand new platform, or can these existing platforms we use keep adding on and keep adding on and keep adding on? Or at some point, is it like a house of cards that you've added on so much stuff that nothing gets used because you can't find it? It's overwhelming and it just collapses.
So to speak on the, you know, add-ons aspect, it is, you know, as a consumer, it is really frustrating. And as a person who works in social media, it's frustrating too, because the same thing that people are consuming on the front end of just like using the tool to interact with people that they know, the same thing happens on the back end of Meta, for example. Like how you run ads changes all the time. Business manager changes all the time. The way Pages operates changes all the time. I actually have somebody on my staff who's like in charge of knowing all the changes because I can't keep up with them. I used to feel like I knew every tool and how to use everything on social media. And I've become comfortable when a client asks me a question now and I don't know the answer to it. But before, I would have been mortified if I didn't know the answer to it. But now I understand that that's just kind of an unrealistic expectation with new tools. But the reason why this behavior exists on social media platforms is, here's sort of how social media platforms rise. They, you know, you kind of have early adopters, and then there goes into like a major sign up phase where everyone signs up and wants to join. And then at some point, there's nobody left in the world to sign. There's no population to sign up for your platform. So what you have to do is you have to create these new verticals to create signups and to create growth and to create new revenue streams, because otherwise you're going to be in a position where your platform is either going to stall or start falling because it's so popular that there's no people left to consume it. So you have to create new things for them to use and sell to them rather than expanding the tool that you already have, because there's nobody left in that to sign up for the original tool. So that's sort of the problem that we get into. And, you know, MySpace didn't do that and they failed. And I think everyone is worried about becoming MySpace. So they are going to, I think there's no way the platform's still existing. I think they're still going to be innovating new tools and figuring out how to get market share and all new trends, because I think they realize that that's their tombstone if they don't, unfortunately, even though it is frustrating from a consumer standpoint sometimes.
Yeah. Let's talk about strategy on the music side. One of my pet peeves is when I go and look at a label, an artist, and it's buy my album, see my show, buy my album, see my show. And it's just this barking out and there's no relationship, there's no dialogue, there's no, and then I'll stumble upon an artist. You know, one of them I stumbled upon a year or two ago was Alice Cooper. And what I loved about his socials was he wasn't telling you about, you know, the Hollywood vampires or his tour or whatever. He was saying, hey, did you see this car? This is a really cool car. Or here's this haunted house. And I noticed that he had a lot of engagement. What's your strategy when it comes to maybe music on the music side, how you engage and keep an audience?
So something that a friend of mine made a long time ago, it's called the social media food pyramid. You can Google it and look it up. Her name's Ariel. She's really smart and awesome and has been doing digital for a long time. But there's this thing called the social media food pyramid. And it, you know, it's probably a little dated, at least the version I have of it, because it was made a long time ago. But the premise of it still stands is that, like, the use sparingly part is at the top. And the use sparingly in this situation means like straight direct promo. So buy my album, buy my merch, buy my tickets. That's kind of the last thing. And it's important to include promotion to a certain extent, because I get some artists who are scared of promotion for that reason. They don't want to come off as pushing something down somebody's throat. And you do want to let your fans know about, you know, they do follow you because they do care about if you release a new album. They do care about if you're on tour and coming to their city. They do care if you make a cool piece of merchandise that they would want to wear. Like, they do want to know about that stuff, but they don't want to be sold all the time either. So it's just all about balance. And I think that pyramid really sort of captures not just that aspect of, like, not everything can be promo, but also the aspect of not everything about your social media can just be you standing on a podium and posting about yourself, even if it is cool, creative content. A big part of social media is being social. So we have to comment on other people's posts. We need to answer our messages. We need to respond to comments that we get. We need to be the first to leave comments on other people's platforms sometime versus waiting for everybody to come to us. We need to like post. We need to tell other people that they did a good job and celebrate their wins. But I think a lot of artists get so focused on curating their feed that they forget about talking to other people and celebrating other people. And, you know, like you said earlier, if you're just standing on a podium and telling people to buy stuff, that gets old and people don't want to be a part of that community. So you have to be, well-rounded and be robust. And actually, I think some of the best strategies I've seen and some of the most memorable moments I've seen are sometimes when artists interact with each other or they you know, elevate a funny fan comment or that sort of thing. But
absolutely.
And it actually takes the heat off of you too. That means you don't have to create every moment that you have on social media. You can be a part of somebody else's, and that's still social media marketing.
Yeah. I've always been a big fan of fan generated content. I don't think enough artists pay attention to what their fans are posting and doing. There is an incredible amount of great content that fans love to share, and they're naturally sharing it, whether it's, you know, them standing in front of a tour poster at a venue, or, you know, sharing a ticket stub from 10 years ago, or anything along those lines. You can share that stuff. And first of all, it's just great content. But second of all, that fan is going to go through the roof when you share their content. When you, as the artist, recognize them and then share it for everybody else, man, you've almost cemented a relationship right there without even having to get into a conversation.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, you didn't have to go get your camera out yourself for that moment. You know, it's really a great situation all around.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, I like the engagement from artists with their fans. And I notice that the growth is exponential. So for example, I'm an artist and I roll in and say, hey, I'm coming to your town in a couple of weeks. What should be on the set list? What should we talk about? And then someone will answer and they go, oh, I like that cover tune. I like the next thing you know, you got a dialogue going on. And then it just kind of organically just starts to grow naturally because more people are interested and they feel like they're a part of the conversation. You see that too?
Yeah, for sure. And a lot of times I like to toss, you know, if we're having a conversation internally about what should we do about merch or what other countries should we consider on a tour, whatever like that. Sometimes it's fun to just toss it on Twitter and see, you know, and get a wider response base versus just people that work with you. You're going to definitely see some things that you wouldn't have thought of if you do that.
Yeah. Yeah. I find social media can be one of those things that can, I mean, there's mental health implications. You can't do everything as an artist. You can't do write, record, tour, and then do Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, TikTok. I mean, you can't do all that stuff. What do you tell artists about that? Would you have them maybe focus on one of those that they're good at, like maybe Instagram, or would you have them get their evangelist or street team, meaning their boyfriends and girlfriends, you know, or friends to kind of help? How do you manage? Because that's a lot today for artists to take on.
It is a lot. And I think that artists should try to do everything themselves until they can't anymore, until there's not enough time in the day. And once you start having a little success, that moment comes pretty quickly. It's kind of like the same premise of, you know, you don't need a manager till you have something to manage. So, you know, I say do your social media until you've built something that becomes robust enough where you need help. I think teams like my company are important. If you are not at the point where you have the budget to hire a agency like a CrowdSurf, I think even finding that, you know, there's a lot of people that are interested in social media, finding somebody local who can help you part-time, even a couple hours a day. There's a lot of different ways to solve that problem. And you kind of have to direct the ship in terms of telling them what to do. But I think sort of sourcing help at some point with social media, I think is really important, especially if you're in a position where you are touring or recording for a long period of time. I think you kind of have to. It's just impossible to be driving a van and also like remember your social media calendar and then all the other obligations you have as an artist outside of just touring and social media, you know, answering so many other questions, finance questions, publishing questions. It's a lot to do. So I think as soon as you are in a position where you have more than 40 hours a week of work to do as an artist, you know, maybe start thinking about who could be your first team members to sort of build out and how you financially handle that.
Yeah.
What's your thought on the social networks moving into subscription models?
I mean, I don't know if anybody's nailed how I think the financial model should work yet. I don't know if I have a clear vision on how I think it should work. What I do like about it is that in terms of the verification badge, I do think it was time for that to be reinvented and not just something that, you know, because the verification badge existed originally because it verified that that profile was who that person said it was.
Right.
And at the time, the only people really being impersonated for the most part were celebrities. But now, I mean, think about how many people post on Facebook that this person that added you on Facebook isn't me. This Instagram profile isn't me. Like normal people are victims of it now. So I think the verification badge is necessary for the general public now because of all these different profiles and scams and that sort of thing. The same way that it's kind of been integrated into dating apps, it verifies that like this person is in the pictures and it matched their ID and the selfie that they took. I think that that's where this kind of goes in terms of, and I understand there's a cost to the social network and, you know, having to verify these profiles. I get that and completely understand that. Do I think that it should be for verification specifically? Do I think that that should be something that costs money on an ongoing basis. I find that model to be a little strange. I understand some of the other tools and things that can be used being a subscription model, but I kind of almost feel like verification should be a separate thing, one-time fee. And then if you change your name or change your ID or something, maybe you have to verify it again for the same fee. But that's kind of how I would have, you know, dream case, you know, scenario would have structured it. But I do agree that there needs to be changes. And even if we hit some bumps along the way, I think that ultimately the changes will lead to a more positive thing. And I think that the social networks having more income this way versus advertising will ultimately be a positive thing too. Because right now we get jammed so many ads because that's how they have to pay for the platform. And I'm hoping that, you know, I know ads will always exist, but I'm hoping that creates sort of a better balance if they have an additional source of income somewhere else.
I sort of feel
on
like
board. Go ahead, Mike.
I was just going to say to follow up on that, you know, and you're right. You know, there's the road bumps, the speed bumps. I think, unfortunately, that's all we've had with these rollouts right now. And I guess my concern is, when you pay, what actually are you getting? Because as we've seen, okay, you can get verified, but now fake people are getting verified. So that defeats that whole point of it. And then they're like, oh, well, we'll promise to expose you to more. Your tweet or your posts on the social network will get greater reach and be exposed to more people. I don't know if I've actually seen any evidence that that's happening yet. And just how many more are, you know, in the case of like, you know, a Facebook, or are my Facebook page posts going from reaching 3% to just 5%? Or is it going to reach 100%? You know, I feel like that's, none of these services have clearly outlined exactly what you're going to get, other than some very kind of vague, high level promises. And I'm all for subscriptions. I mean, I subscribe to a ton of software, but you know what you're getting. And I think that's the problem social networks have right now, is we just don't know what you're getting for paying for that.
Yeah, I agree with that. And I do think that it is, like, I get why they want to do it. And in like high level theory, I'm on board with it, but it is very vague right now. And I think right now people are paying for it because they want the verification badge, but I don't think I feel kind of weird about that being subscription. I feel like that should be a one-time fee, in my opinion. And then the other stuff is very vague. Like, what does more reach mean? Like, you know, I don't know.
Can I stop advertising if I pay for my subscription because now I'm going to reach everybody? I don't see that ever happening. I don't see them giving you enough reach that you no longer have to advertise, because now they're cutting their throat somewhere else.
Yeah, because they're going to make more money if you advertise to reach your full audience versus $10 or $15 a month or whatever. So I think it's flawed. And I think that there's kind of almost two different markets. Like, I think that the verification situation should be just general public. We want to keep you safe. Here's this tool, one-time fee, so we can verify you. I watched somebody verify themselves as Gwyneth Paltrow, and nice. They stayed up for, you know, the tweets were funny. They stayed up online for a pretty long time before they got suspended. But, you know, that poses the question, like, how, you know, if you're going to verify somebody, like, that person should probably be showing you an ID that matches that name.
100%.
The same way a dating app does. Like,
I mean, we've all wanted verification. I mean, that's the number one thing clients are always asking me. It's like, can you get me verified? Well, in the past, no, you can't promise a verification. To your initial point, it was all built on, is there a threat of impersonation? Well, no. If you're not a public figure or you're not that important and nobody's impersonated you, you're not going to get verified. We want it, but the problem is they've already broken that system by verifying people who weren't the person they were claiming to be. And that that kind of destroys confidence in this whole process that they're doing. I mean, you know, what is it? You know, in just this last week, Elon's like, oh, well, I think we're going to reduce the price for verifications or whatever for small businesses. So it's not as expensive as it is for a major business. Well, why didn't you think this out up front?
Yeah. I mean, I think the problem is that there's not, I feel like, and again, I don't have any insight, but from what I see, I feel like there's a lack of like advising or listening to advising. You know, for example, I saw Elon tweet something about how, you know, most celebrities don't tweet for themselves. And I'm like, that's actually not true. And if you had a talent team that didn't leave or get let go, you would have been able to ask them and consult them before you made that claim. But you know, that's what, you know, I don't know. I'm not able to verify everything that he says or is true or isn't true. But in that one, I do know because I work in that field. And I'm like, no, most celebrities, especially if it's like an individual person on the Twitter account, they may have a social media team, but they're either hitting send themselves or they're approving everything in almost every right. circumstance. So yeah, that's just not accurate to say. But he didn't consult anybody, because if he would have consulted somebody, he would have known that wasn't the right, that wouldn't have been a smart thing to say about that topic. So
yeah, instead of just assuming.
Yeah. I think a lot of assumptions are being made about like what people want and what businesses want versus asking educated people and doing market research before these tools are being rolled out. And I think that's why we're seeing all these flaws and people are using them and pointing out the flaws, like the Gwyneth Paltrow account, for example.
You mean throwing up a Twitter poll is not deep educated research into what people want?
Oh man. I mean, listen, I do like a lot of things about him, and I do like, there's a lot of things I do like about him. He's obviously been very impactful in the world, but no, I don't agree with the Twitter poll strategy. I think that's a very skewed way to determine, to make big decisions.
Yeah.
100%.
Let me ask you about your onboarding process, because I think what's really important, especially today, is, you know, once you have your goals set, but it's finding that audience. Right? It's all about finding your tribe. When you onboard an audience, I'm sure that artist, manager, whoever has an idea who their audience is. But I found that that's not always entirely accurate, depending on what venues they play, depending on if they're looking at socials or commerce or touring or whatever. How do you kind of help them to see who their audience really is, and then maybe who it should be and who you should be targeting?
So yeah, there's a lot of little nuances that go into that. And you're right, sometimes people either don't know or they want their audience to be something that it's not. When we onboard, I do like to, you know, use the standard analytic tools that are built into social platforms to see, you know, roughly like who is currently like sort of engaging and listening to this artist. And then I like to ask the client in onboarding, like, who do you want your audience to be, or who do you think it should be? And sometimes there's a bridge to get there. Or sometimes we recommend pivoting in a different direction, because sometimes they want an audience that I think doesn't make sense. They also a lot of times want an audience, they just say everyone. And I'm like, that's not a good audience to start with. You may be able to get to everyone one day, but you have to start a little more specific in the beginning. It doesn't have to be one group, but maybe a couple, you know, different types of people. But, you know, I was actually, so I have an artist who's going out on the road with Hunter Hayes. And I went to the show. She wasn't opening, but I went to the show in LA on Sunday because I wanted to see, I wasn't able to predict what the audience would be. I'm like, I don't know. Is this going to be like people who liked Wanted when they were younger? Is this going to be like traditional country fans? I'm not sure. There's definitely a couple different buckets of types of people, but definitely young, like mostly younger females. And I wouldn't have been able to predict that exactly. So it is important to investigate both digitally and in person to kind of understand who somebody's audience is.
Yeah, agreed. Yeah, I had an artist who was playing a lot of performing arts centers, and as you know, people subscribe to those. And a lot of times they just want to have a glass of wine and see a nice show. And they don't really care who that artist is. It's a subscription type thing. And it's a little older, more affluent. And just because you see those people in the audience doesn't necessarily mean that's your audience. So I think that's spot on.
Totally.
I want to get back to a little bit. Let's kind of circle back and wrap up here on TikTok again, because I feel like that is the biggest thing I have conversations with clients about. It's TikTok, TikTok, TikTok. And almost to the point where, you know, we've got a, Jay and I have a saying Jay came up with, you know, a playlist is not a marketing plan. Well, TikTok is not a marketing plan. You can't put everything you do into TikTok and think that's where it's, I've heard people say it's like, well, it's the new MySpace. People get discovered on TikTok and get record deals like they got off of MySpace. And it's like, you can't do that. What is, you know, in a 2 minute conversation here, what's a strategy on TikTok? How would you integrate TikTok into everything you're doing?
So I always, just with social media in general, I like to ask clients to think about what, if it was the 1970s, what are your career goals? Your career goals need to exist out of social media, and then you need to use social media to build to your career goals. So with TikTok, yes, you should be posting it, but I really like to tell people, think about TikTok as a platform where you post video. It's not about chasing trends. It's not about engagement. It's about how do you support, how do you create and post video content that support your career and are an extension of your art. I like to really make it as simple as possible. And I think a lot of times making it simple makes the ideas of what type of content they should post become more clear.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. So Cassie, when people are looking to learn more about, you know, everything that you're up to, whether it's CrowdSurf or you personally, where do people go to learn more about you?
So I'm mostly on my Instagram and LinkedIn, just Cassie Petrie, CassiePetrey. And surprisingly, on the CrowdSurf front, we don't really share much, because we actually find that the less we share, the better we do, because people make negative assumptions when you share. So
yeah,
that's kind of where our social media strategy sits right now. It actually does better with less.
I like that.
Yeah.
Thanks so much for joining us, Cassie. We really appreciate it. I love
the conversation. Thank you for having me. Yeah. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
Visit discmakers.com to place an order for 100 or more CDs. And when you check out, use promo code FREEBIZ and get free shipping.
Jay, it's always fun talking, you know, what's going on in social media, because social media is probably very much like the music business. It changes so damn fast.
Yeah. And it's misunderstood, I think, a lot.
Oh, it is.
I think people make assumptions about social media.
It is. It's, you know, there's a lot of, not even assumptions and misunderstanding. A lot of people just don't have time, rightfully so, to dig into, as she was talking about, what's changing this week on Facebook, and what's TikTok doing, and what's Instagram doing. It changes every, not just weekly.
It's a full-time job trying to keep up with all of that stuff.
Yeah. And, you know, again, I experience the frustration, and I hear it from clients who try and do it on their own. It's like, I was just doing this yesterday and now it's gone, or it's now broken. Or
I hear that from you a lot. It's like, you'll say, hey, what about that thing? Did that break for you too? And I'm like, yeah, you know, it was there last week.
It was there last week. And then, you know, it comes down to, well, it's not broken in the iPhone app, but it's broken in the desktop version. And it's, you know, and the feature's only available on the desktop version. You can't get it in the feature set for the same app that's on your smartphone. You know, there's incredible stuff like that. And it's just, it's good to have these conversations to stay up with what's going on. And, you know, the TikTok, the short form video, we've talked about it before. It is so important, but
today it is
again, it's always changing. I mean, you know, 6 months ago, Facebook was becoming TikTok, and did it happen? From my experience, nothing's really changed.
But they YouTube thought it would.
YouTube Shorts has really come out of nowhere and become very important.
Yeah, it was Instagram Reels for a long time, and now YouTube Shorts are kind of the pretty girl on the block and overperforming. And to your point, though, it's not that there's a right or wrong answer. It's that you have to watch this stuff because it's evolving and changing every week, and it's ebbing and flowing. And anybody who says they've got it down is either naive or isn't paying attention, because it's changed while we've been having this conversation. You really need to do what Cassie does, which is has one person watching all of those changes for you. It's hard to keep up with all of this.
Yeah, 100%. Let's just, you know, quick shout out. Thank you to Bruce and everybody at Hypebot and Bandsintown. And listen, I mean, we've said it so many times, but I absolutely love Bandsintown. It is, and not just because we've got a great relationship with them. That website is so freaking useful. I mean, I'm testing out some beta features they've got now. I love the way Bandsintown is growing, expanding, and adding new features. And honestly, it's new features that are actually really useful to an artist. Very useful features.
It's funny you mentioned that, because I had a tour this morning. Francois took me through a really nice tour of things to update me on all of the new stuff. And I'm working with them. One of my artists has this big tour coming up, and they're working with me to make sure we target every single market and get their audience involved. And it's such a great platform.
It really is. I can't stress this enough, because I still, you probably see this too daily, artists that don't have their tour dates up on Bandsintown, they've not even claimed their Bandsintown profile. Have to go please, if you do anything coming out of this episode, go claim your Bandsintown profile and make sure all your tour dates are in Bandsintown, and they always get added there.
Yeah.
Just start with that one thing. Then you can start digging into all the other cool stuff that Bandsintown offers.
Check out the widget and all the things you can customize.
The email list, the messages you can send to people. Just go claim your profile. It's just beyond me how many artists out there just like, I've got shows, but I can't sell tickets. It's like, your tour dates aren't posted anywhere. Go do that.
Right.
And so thank you to Bruce at Hypebot and Bandsintown. And of course, to our sponsor, discmakers.com. Thank you so much. That's it. Music Biz Weekly Podcast. We'll see everybody next week.
Industry professionals listen to the Music Biz Weekly Podcast. If you have a product or service and would like to reach this audience, get in touch with Michael or Jay to discuss sponsorship opportunities.
For Music Biz Weekly, provided by LarryDavisVoice.com. And by JessicaMarsVoice.com. That's Mars with a Z.